Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is David Cerns, CEO at Haley Marketing. When it comes to marketing a staffing firm, few people know the industry like David. He literally grew up in the business and has been helping staffing companies create innovative marketing strategies and award-winning websites for more than 20 years. Websites, social media, SEO, blogging, email marketing, PPC. For more than 20 years, Haley Marketing has served the staffing industry. Their work has won more than 65 Genius and Voice Awards from ASA, and they have helped you stand out and stay on top of mind and sell more. In today's Industry Insider webinar, we'll review recommendations from some of the smartest people in the world about how to plan for and even thrive in economic downturns. We'll also take a look at some of the marketing techniques staffing companies have used to limit their losses during the Great Recession and recover significantly faster than the majority of firms in the industry. By the end of the session, you'll know how to plan for, recover faster, and even thrive in turbulent economic times. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat feature. After the presentation, there will be time for us to go through questions. With that, I will turn the floor over to David.
Thanks so much, Amanda, and thank you everybody for taking some time out of your day to join us for today's webinar. And a big thanks to everyone at Tricom for putting this on. So Amanda said, you know, we're here to talk about strategies that you can use right now. And to get things kicked off, I'm actually going to kind of go back in time. And originally, first time I put this presentation together was middle of March. And I don't know about you, but to me, that feels like it was about 400 years ago. But just looking at what's happened then till now, and then sort of looking at what's going to happen now till the fall, we really need to think differently about staffing. You know, 3.5, 4 months ago, it was 3.5% unemployment and everything was about recruiting and could we fill job orders? And now for most of you, it's probably, how do we get enough job orders? And even when we have job orders, how do we recruit? Because getting people to come off of unemployment, getting people to be comfortable going back into the workplace, it's all new and it's all different and everything about what we have to do needs to change. So we're going to, barely 1 second. All right, so if you think back to the beginning of this year, the reaction we had, most of it is we didn't see this happening. Nobody could envision what we're going through. And when we first saw the news out of Wuhan, China, nobody knew where that was. Nobody thought twice about it. It was something on the nightly news. And our reaction in January was, it's not going to happen here. And then, you know, I'm in New York State, and it hit California, it hit Seattle, it hit New York. And you still see it on the news, but mentally you're detached from what's going on, and you just sort of think, I hope everyone else will be all right, because it's not going to affect me. This isn't really here. And then it was in your town. It was in your state. It affected your staffing business. And part of it is you're telling yourself that this just can't be real. It's like a movie script. This isn't reality. This is something we read about in a history book. This isn't what we're experiencing. And for most of us, somewhere around the middle of March, our attitudes changed and it became, what am I going to do? How will I get through this? How are my clients going to be impacted? How are my people going to be impacted? What will I do if someone gets sick? And right now, the what am I going to do has changed to, how are we going to get open back up? What are our policies going to be? Some of you may have offices that are fully open, others that are still fully closed. What are you going to do next? What are your clients going to do? It's no secret that we got walloped with the 1-2 punch. And everybody knows about the number one punch, coronavirus, because that started somewhere around December of last year. Obviously, it hit the U.S. economy in March. And if you looked at the news last week, in a lot of the Sun Belt states through to California, we're now seeing an explosion in infection. I think Florida it went up 25% in a week. And then the double whammy we got was we got hit by this game of chicken that Russia played with Saudi Arabia back in late February and early March, and oil prices. And oil price wars, while they're good for our gas tank and our personal wallet as consumers, they're actually really bad, and disruption in the energy industry is really bad for the U.S. economy. So our clients got walloped with a change in business, a change in cost, all at the same time, something we've never seen before. On March 17th, 2020, the very smart people at Morgan Stanley and Goldman Sachs declared officially that we were in a global recession. Now, normally for a recession to occur, you have to see 2 quarters in a row of declining gross domestic product or GDP. This was 2 weeks in, and we had fallen already so fast that two of the largest banks could say we're in a global recession. Happy St. Patrick's Day. What a way to celebrate. But the real question is, we're now dealing with something the staffing industry has not seen in more than a decade, the R word, recession. Some of you may have been in the industry in 2008, 2009. Some of you may have been in here longer. Amanda mentioned I grew up in the staffing industry, so I saw recessions in mom and dad's business in the 70s and in the 80s. I lived through one in the early 90s, and then when Healy Marketing Group was around, we've witnessed two of them. But some of you haven't been in the staffing industry more than 10 years. And if you haven't been in the industry more than 10 years, you've never seen a situation like we've been facing in compound recession with pandemic, and none of us have ever experienced this before. So by definition, a recession is a significant decline in economic activity spread across the entire economy, lasting more than a few months, visible in GDP, real gross domestic product, real income, employment, industrial production, and wholesale and retail sales all falling. So we've seen all of this. And it sort of blows my mind that normally something that takes 6 months happened in 2 weeks. And this definition sort of, it both makes me smile, but it's also very serious. You know, it makes me smile because it's a joke. You know, a recession is when a friend loses their job, and a depression is when you lose yours. Well, unfortunately, depressions happen to a lot of our friends, our family members. A lot of the staffing industry, if you look back at the last two recessions, 2001 and 2009, approximately 30% of staffing companies didn't survive, and that's depression. So today is not about depression. Today, we're going to spend the next 50 minutes talking about ideas to help drive growth. So we want to make sure that you're going to take home some things that you can do that ensure that you're not the companies that are suffering from depression coming out of the COVID-19 recession. So there are lots of things that cause a recession. I'm not going to read you everything on the screen. You can look at the list and say, yeah, we've got a lot of these things that I've seen happen. Not all these things. Any one of these things can cause a recession. We've actually had several of them all happen all at the same time, but it's that last bullet I think is the great unknown, fear. When people are afraid, they don't spend money. They don't take action. They wait. Some people will be bold. Great. Those would be great clients. We're going to talk more about those. A lot of companies just sit on the sidelines waiting for things to get better. They get super cautious. And when people are afraid, they don't invest. And that has an impact. So what happens in a recession? Well, people and companies spend less. There's less business activity. There's less work, so there's less need for workers. And you've seen this. Hours get cut. Flexible workers get let go. Unemployment, in this case, skyrockets. Bad debt tends to go up, and prices and interest rates tend to fall, with the exception of the grocery store. That's happened. Now, interest rates are now at an all-time low near zero. It's a great time to refinance a mortgage. But it's not such a great time because of all these things that are going on in a recession, not such a great time for staffing and recruiting. So in staffing companies, you know, again, you probably know the pain here. Companies have hiring freezes. That means there's little or no direct hire. Temps are the first ones to get let go because, after all, we sold our clients on the value of flexibility. They don't need people. They can get rid of their flexible staff. Job orders become scarce. We have to fight harder. In fact, I heard another consultant in the industry talking about that you're going to have to work twice as hard right now for half the results. And as I mentioned, up to 30%, nearly a third of staffing companies don't survive times like these. But it's not all bad news. There are parts of the economy doing well. Parts that have temporarily hurt will bounce back. Healthcare, first it went up right away in the first 2 weeks and the beginning as hospitals needed people. They were desperate. They were offering incredible crisis pay rates. Then that simmered down, but they still weren't doing elective surgeries and they took massive losses. But now there's pent-up demand for those elective surgeries and healthcare is likely to boom again as people go back to taking care of themselves through their local healthcare systems. Mortgage rates go down, so refinancing goes up. IT tends to be pretty recession-proof, and some of our clients are seeing this, that they're seeing an increase in demand. Others have said, no, we dealt with companies that got impacted, so they saw a decrease. So it tends to even out this time because of cybersecurity and the need for digitalization of businesses. I think you're going to see IT continue to grow. Collections goes up. Bad debt goes up. Collections goes up. Big call center business. They're going to need staff. No question consumer staples. I don't know about you, but I can't get a thing of Clorox wipes at the supermarket. They can't keep up with demand. Thank goodness the toilet paper is finally back. But all of the things that people are buying more of, now that I think we're past the hoarding phase, there's still tremendous demand throughout the supply chain, for consumer staples, and that's going to drive a lot of need for temps in manufacturing and distribution. Discount retailers do well. If you look at the 2001 recession, it was owned by Walmart. 2009 really drove Amazon's growth. What will this one drive? Well, Amazon's already doing well. But who else is going to survive? You're going to see more e-commerce businesses, and people who can reduce costs to consumers tend to do well. Thin industries, alcohol, tobacco, and there's a third one, gambling, that tend to do well. The first two are doing very well. Alcohol consumption is up over 200%. I don't know how much tobacco is up, but it's probably up as well. Gambling is not up. Gambling is down because people can't go to be together. But thin industries do well, and they need people. And then the one that always sort of astonishes me, and when I look at the list, is cosmetics tend to actually go up in a recession, not down, even though they're expensive. As it turns out, there is a category of goods called small luxuries. And when people are emotionally hurting, as most of us are now, we will invest in small luxuries to make ourselves feel better. And cosmetics is one example of a small luxury. So if you look at your clients, which clients provide products, deliver services, that could be considered small luxuries because people will consume those and those organizations will need talent. All right. But I didn't really want to get on today's webinar to talk about the past. Most of our time today is talking about strategies for the future. And so in preparing for this webinar, I went and looked at different ways to get through. And I said, you know what, let's look back in time and let's look for some people who are really smart to see how did they recommend getting through the recession. Now, this isn't staffing industry specific, but I went to places like Harvard Business Review. And I went to a number of the big name management consulting companies. And I went to some smaller management consulting companies. And I just tried to find advice that I could bring to the staffing industry to share from people who were really, really smart. So let me summarize a few things. And I'm going to sort of forewarn you. Today's presentation, there's a ton of content. And like I'm going to talk fast to get through all of it in the next 45 minutes. But this is a synopsis of a synopsis. So each slide you're about to see summarizes an entire article or research paper from an organization in one slide. There's a website I'm going to give you at the end, so stick around for that, where you can get a longer format synopsis. So like the ones that we're about to look at is about 40 pages of content that we summarized. And then in that document, if you really want to read all the source documents, there's links to everything. So let me get through this synopsis of the synopsis, but if questions pop up, use that question box, go ahead and ask, and we'll do our best to answer questions as we go, or anything we can't get to, we'll save to the end. All right, so how do you get through a recession? So the first article from Harvard Business Review was talking about strategies, and the first strategy is one that we're a little late to the game, deleverage. So what you're trying to do there is make sure that you don't have a lot of debt and that your margins are positive so you don't run out of money. This is where companies like Tricon come into play, is to making sure you're turning your receivables into cash, to make sure that you have good financial planning. You want to make sure that even if you're making $1 of profit, You're making zero, but you're breaking even. You stay in business. And when the rebound occurs, you'll do really well. The companies that go out of business run out of money. Number two, focus on how you make decisions. If you're a one-office staffing company, that this bullet's not really for you, but if you have multiple branches, or if you're part of a big franchise organization or bigger staffing company, when you have really hard decisions to make, like do we go into this new line of business? Do we cut staff? Do we make a capital investment? Those kinds of really hard decisions are best centralized, made by senior management. But when you have decisions that are customer facing, like do we take this job order? Can we take on this risk? Training your branch managers so that you can make decisions decentralized out in the field faster allows you to be more responsive. And we're in an economy when speed wins. So you want to use this concept of centralized for tough and decentralized for speed. If you need to cut your own costs, don't just look at laying people off. What this article recommended is cut costs through operational improvements, because if you cut people, you have less talent available to recover. If you improve process and people can do more, now you can recover faster. And this bullet is as much for staffing companies as it is for your clients. When your clients are saying, no, we've got to cut headcount, we can't hire anybody. Well, if they're reducing their ability to react to the market demand rebounding, they're hurting their own ability to recover. And this is something you might get this full article and consult with your clients about, on how to maintain staff so they can recover faster. And the last one from this article is about investing in technology. And it can seem really painful to make a big investment in technology, but for a lot of us, we have more time. It's a great time to put in new systems because we can focus on learning, focus on implementing it well. You also want systems that allow you to become more transparent with clients and candidates so you have better communication with them, to be more flexible so you can react faster, or just overall make your business more efficient so that your cost of service delivery is now less. It costs you less per placed candidate. It costs you less per sale. All right, our second article is entitled Roaring Out of a Recession. And here, kind of a different take on some of the similar points. The first two lessons go hand in hand. Don't be too defensive. Don't be too aggressive. I mentioned companies, when they're afraid, they sort of curl into a ball. Think of like an armadillo. They just curl up and try to defend themselves. Well, you're going to have clients who are doing that. They don't spend any money. And they don't spend any money, you don't get any sales. So companies that are really defensive may weather the storm, but they actually tend to take the longest to recover, and they recover the least of the companies with the next two strategies. The second lesson is to not be too aggressive. You may have some clients that are sort of like, damn the torpedoes. We're going full on. This is an opportunity to take out our competitors. This is an opportunity to pursue new markets. They're going to become super aggressive. If you look at the biggest dot-com companies, they were started after recessions. Their explosive growth happened after, last one, after 2009. Uber came out of there. Amazon went from being unprofitable to being wildly profitable all in the last 10 years. So some of those companies that get really aggressive, they actually, if they survive, will recover faster than those from number one. They'll also recover more strongly than those from number one, but they're far more likely to go out of business because they're saying, damn the torpedoes, and in the process of doing that, they actually don't see the torpedoes. The ideal way for your company to pursue growth right now is an optimal balance, to become what this article termed a progressive company. Look at everything you do to service your clients. How can we make it faster? How can we make it less costly? How can we make it more enjoyable? Improve the process, and building in permanent cost reductions through fewer touches, through a lower cost touches, through automation. Invest right now to develop new markets and enlarge your assets. And this means build on what you're good at. If you're really good as a light industrial staffing company, don't go after healthcare because there might be demand in healthcare. Get better at light industrial. Get better at other things your light industrial clients need, other skill disciplines, maybe moving up the value chain, which we'll talk more about later. And increase your spending on R&D, research and development, and marketing. This article talked about companies that do the best actually do more in a recession to develop new products and services and to market more aggressively. And we're going to talk more about that at length in a little bit. All right, our third article and the last from HBR, how to market in a downturn. And I really like this one because it was an eye-opener to me. And I've been doing marketing for a long time. And what they said is understand recession psychology. Now, typically when you guys think about targeting your clients, you might think about segmenting customers based on size of the company, location, the industry they're in, their approach to staffing. But we're using all kinds of demographic criteria. But what this article said is, no, right now in a downturn, you need to think about psychology and psychographics, how people react to bad news. And in the article, they said there's four types of consumers. And quick side note, this article wasn't written for staffing. It wasn't written for B2B selling. It was written for business to consumer. So a lot of the analogies used here are more about individuals buying goods and services, but they applied to staffing, which is why I wanted to include it. So the first type of buyer is the slam on the brakes. That's your hedgehog. That's your armadillo. They're curling up. They're just stopping all spending everywhere they can. The second are the pain but patient. They're hurting. They may have cut spending, but they're planning. They know things are going to get better, and they're going to want to work with you as a partner to help plan for the future. These are your best customers tomorrow. The third are the comfortably well-off. They haven't been hurt that badly. Maybe they're in an essential industry. Maybe they provide a particular product that there was still going to be demand for. Maybe they're part of the supply chain in that essential industry. So they're doing all right, and they need people. In fact, you've probably seen some of your essential clients that need way more people. These are your best short-term prospects, identifying companies that are doing well right now and have surprising increased needs for talent. And the last group, which I think applies the least to staffing, is to live for today. Those are the people who just, they don't care what the news says. They don't watch. They're just going to run their business the way they run their business, and they keep spending. Those are the ones who, they may be okay for job orders today. They're also the most likely to implode because they're not planning good or bad for the future. So I think those first three define most businesses you're going to be selling to. And the key to this, and the next bullet here, is about understanding why they buy. Some people buy goods and services because they're essential. If I view temporary staffing as essential to my business, I'm going to continue using temporary staffing. And your job is to show your clients and show prospects how what you do is essential to their business. They can't operate without you. They need the flexibility. They need the cost control. They need the risk management. They need the on-demand access to talent. You have to show them why you're more essential than ever. Then there are people who buy things because they're indulgences. That's the, I buy stuff to make me feel good. I don't think there's a lot of indulgence that goes into staffing buying, but there may be some indulgences with people who will pursue a new market opportunity. They're going to take their cash and invest it. When you're talking with your clients, ask them if they're small businesses, did you get PPP money? What are you using it for? Maybe they want to keep their temps working to focus on new business development. Maybe they want to actually bring in more people to focus on growth. Maybe they didn't get PPP. Maybe they're a bigger organization, but they're an organization that's still looking to invest in places. And I would treat those companies making investments sort of similar to that category of indulgences. And what you're trying to do is fulfill their need to indulge, their need for talent. The next two are the ones to be cautious of. People who view their investment in you as postponable. I don't really need the people right now. They're going to be the ones that you need to talk to them and move them from, no, this talent isn't postponable, it's essential. You have to teach your salespeople how to help your clients transition their view of the projects those people are doing from non-essential to essential. Because if it's essential, they keep people staffed. If it's postponable, yeah, they're going to come up. They're the pain but patient group, but they're going to stop using staffing in the short term. You won't be able to convert all of those, but if you can get a percentage of your clients to do that, you're going to retain more of the business. And lastly are things that are expendable, things your clients are just going to cut. And if your people are working in departments that are expendable, that's a big risk. So you really need to know those are coming. So you can either help clients convert those to being more essential or get ready for the talent who's going to be coming off and figure out how you can redeploy them. So in terms of marketing, the goal is to make your business more essential. We'll talk about ways to add more value later on. You can lower the cost of indulgences. Maybe I can create a lower cost version of our services. Maybe there's a way to do temp to hire at a lower fee or direct hire services at a lower fee or a different payment plan that makes it more affordable. Maybe there's ways to unbundle services so that I can reduce markups or reduce fees. And I want to increase the urgency of postponables by getting my clients to see what could be. Show them the future. Share these articles. Show them how companies investing in R&D, new markets, grow faster, recover faster, because investing in R&D and new markets means those clients are going to need talent. All right, now we're going to move out of the world of Harvard Business Review and on to one of the management consulting firms, Bain & Company. And I'll warn you, the next few slides, we're going to start to see some redundancy. I chose to leave them in the presentation because if I saw multiple really smart people saying the same thing, it probably means that the idea was definitely worth following. This article was written about 2 years ago from the folks at Bain & Company. And what they said is the next recession, whenever it happens, and they didn't know we were going to have coronavirus, the next recession is going to be the end of non-tech businesses. Now, we're in staffing, a business that's typically seen as a relationship business. So how do we make sure we're transitioning to the fact that the world's going to be digital? How do we build relationships in a digital world when you're seeing it now when you're selling, when I don't see clients face-to-face? Some of you may have never envisioned you'd sell remotely, and now all of it's remote. How do I transition to the world of online staffing so I can do service delivery without having to be in a client's office, maybe providing remote workers? How do I use technology to enhance the service process? What Bain & Company said is the next recession will be the end of companies that do not embrace technology at the core of what they do. They also said the historic low interest rates that we have are going to be going away. And that was before they cut them to zero. So there's no way the U.S. economy can sustain the interest rates we have near zero for an extended period of time. So when interest rates go up, what happens? Companies tend to invest less. So right now, you may have more clients saying, hey, we can borrow at near zero cost of capital. So we're going to take on infrastructure projects. We're going to take on bigger capital improvements, capital investments. Those drive demands for people. Or maybe they need people to fill in for their key players so their key players can work on those new investments. This is the time to talk to your clients about their investing strategy and what they're doing and are they taking advantage of the low interest rates. And over past recessions, Bain & Company said, winning companies behave differently. Okay, here's a repeat. Restructure costs before the downturn without cutting muscle. Cut the fat. That's good advice at any time, but especially good advice right now. And most of you probably cut, but if there's other things you can cut that are non-essential, this is the time to do it. Put the financial house in order. Make sure that there's cash, repeat of the prior one. But also really analyzing your margins. Is every client profitable? If not, what else can you do to get rid of that client or to increase the margins from that client? Invest selectively for commercial growth. Build around where you're good. Look for new markets. Look for other places where your clients might want to bring you. Look for other needs your clients have inside their organizations. Look for sort of skill disciplines that are one degree away from what you fill today so you can easily move from where you are. So, for example, if I did light industrial, I might move to skilled technical. If I did skilled technical, I might move into engineering. Maintain your marketing. Hey, this is one you're going to hear over and over again, but companies that stop marketing during downturns, most of their clients stop seeing them, and the assumption is the company is really hurting or has gone out of business. And no one wants to work with a company, a vendor, that's really hurting. This is a real time to improve customer experience. What can you do to make it better so that you're not just a little bit better than your competition, you're way better than your competition to both clients and candidates? And if you have the financial resources, this is a great time to look at mergers and acquisitions. This is a good time to buy companies because they're worth a lot less right now than they were 6 months ago, than they were 4 months ago. So if you can afford to do it, it's a great time to acquire. All right, the next one we're going to look at is an article by a company called Signature Analytics. This is another management consulting firm. So far, everything we've been looked at is basically articles written for big business. Well, Signature Analytics is about small companies. And so their advice for small business was, again, look at financially prepared before the downturn happens. Okay, we can't do that. It's already happened. But go look at your balance sheet. Is it strong enough? Do you have enough cash put away for a rainy day? Did you get that PPP money? And if so, what's your game plan for how it's going to be used? What's going to be invested? What's going to be held? Focus on strengthening customer relationships. This is the time to go deeper with every client. Do an audit. Have your salespeople or your recruiters audit your clients and say, what's on a 1 to 10 scale, what's the strength of our relationship? How many people do we have relationships with in that organization? How many vendors do they use? What percentage of the business do we get? What you're trying to figure out is, how strong is the relationship? Think of it like a spider web. If a spider's web only had one strand, it's really weak. But when the spider weaves it into a web, it becomes very strong because it puts all those connections together. You want to do the same thing with your relationships. The more bonds you can create between your organization and your client, at different levels, salesperson, recruiter, administrative contacts, management contacts, to your clients, the stronger it makes those relationships, and the least likely it is you're going to be the staffing vendor that gets kicked out. This is the time to master what your company does best. So again, build around your strengths. Don't try to jump into something you don't know how to do. This is the time to go directly after competitors. Not that you don't always take on competitors, but you can get even more aggressive. You know who your competitors are. You know where their clients are. This is the time to go after your clients very aggressively, because if you've got weaker competitors, this is a time to make them part of the 30% that don't survive. Another piece of advice, don't let marketing fall through the cracks, because out of sight is out of mind. Out of mind means the perception of out of business, and you don't want that to happen to you. Don't get comfortable. And what this means is everything that you're doing, just challenge it. Why do we do this? Is it as good as it can be? How can we make it better? Are our clients loving us in every touch point? Are our candidates loving us? This is the time for process optimization. Not just to cut costs, but also to improve the perception of your service, to create more differentiation. And lastly, maintain good credit. Coming out of this, hopefully you guys are going to see massive growth. And hopefully you're going to work with Tricom to fund that growth. But you want to make sure that you have very good credit so that if you need money, you have the ability to get the money you need when you need it. And hopefully in the next few months, you're going to need that money to fund the payroll as you see the staffing industry rebound. All right, and the last one in this set was a letter just this January from the CEO of Sequoia Capital. And if you don't know Sequoia Capital, they're the largest venture capital company in the U.S., maybe in the world. And their CEO wrote a letter to all of the CEOs of all their portfolio companies, and he called coronavirus the black swan event of 2020. And he was pretty accurate in his predictions. The outbreak is going to result in a drop in business activity, massive supply chain disruptions, curtailment of travel and business meetings. And so their advice, and their, remember, the companies they invest in are all startups. They're startups that have a pile of money and are trying to figure out how to get their business profitable. And what they recommended to these small businesses is, number one, build a cash runway. And I included a note, enough cash to cover a few poor quarters. They were not seeing a V-shaped recession, quick down, quick back up. They were seeing what we're sort of starting to see, which is it's going to fall down fast and come back slowly. So could you write out 3 months, 6 months, 9 months of weak sales? If you can't, you want to look at what can you do to get your cash flow to the point that you can survive if you had a few quarters of bad performance. If you need to raise funding, it's going to get harder to get money. So you need to make sure you have strong funding partners. Hopefully you all have them if you're on today's webinar. But also, if you're in the venture world, plan for a cut in funding. So if you've got any of your clients that are tech startups that rely on venture funding, I'd be worried about them paying their bills, because they may see their cash dry up. And if they've got a burn rate that's negative because they're going through cash so fast, their ability to pay you could disappear. I'd be really, really reticent to service those clients unless they could somehow give me some confidence that they'll be there to pay the bills. This is a time to reforecast your sales from every client. Anticipate what each customer is going to do by talking to them, learning their plans. What are they planning to do? And anticipate the impact on your business. From a marketing standpoint, Sequoia said, this is the time to fight for ROI. You may have had a variety of different marketing activities in the past. Some work better than others. This is time to reevaluate the lower performers and transition that spend to something that produces higher results. We just had a call with our team this morning. We were talking about taking some clients that were doing a lot of stuff on social media for recruiting 4 months ago, and those who haven't already transitioned to other ways to use social for business development to make sure they're making that transition. Headcount. The mantra from every business is going to be do more with less. That was the mantra coming out of 2009. It's going to be the mantra for the rest of 2020, probably 2021. So that's about improving productivity. That's all about staffing, using the right people at the right time to minimize your total cost of labor. In terms of capital spending, big projects, the CEO's advice was to examine whether it makes sense to invest in those projects. If it does, don't pull the investment. Okay, so if making an investment in technology, marketing, new business, or new market development makes sense, even in light of today's market conditions, don't wait. Go, because you're going to get an advantage by moving sooner. And lastly, be opportunistic. Always be on the lookout for opportunities to accelerate your plans, because there may be surprise areas of growth, surprise clients that need more staffing, surprise business sectors you get an opportunity to jump into where it makes sense to make that jump. All right, so that's it from the experts. Now we're going to transition and give you some advice from this group of crazy. So like a lot of you, we've been doing some Zoom-based happy hours, and so we had one a little bit ago. I think this picture was taken at one of them in March. And we asked our team, hey, look at all the things Haley Marketing has written over the years and find any advice you can on surviving a downturn from a marketing perspective. And they dug up a lot. So we went way back to the first article we had written on surviving a recession, and it was written in 2006, just about 2 years before the Great Recession really hit. And I'll take credit for being really paranoid. That's just my owner paranoia. But the advice at that time, which I think is completely relevant today, is how can you lock in your clients? Are there ways to create first call agreements or a volume purchase agreement or a single source agreement, something that gives them an incentive to work with you long-term and maybe you as an exclusive supplier? Maybe there are more companies where you could do on-site management, or more aptly today, remote on-site management, where you're helping companies to better manage their staffing function, moving up that value chain so that you're in a higher position than other staffing companies servicing that same client. So you're more in control of their spend because you've got a true partnership with that organization. The more you can do to lock in clients, the more secure you're making your 2020 cash flow. Expanding client relationships. We have the same recommendations as the experts. This is a time to build broader networks, getting to know people in more departments, and deeper networks, more contacts in each department. You also want to look for opportunities to reduce cost without damaging service. Now, we didn't call it process improvement. We wrote that back in 2006, but this is really what it is. Where are the places we can cut things that we may have done for our clients to try to differentiate, but they're really not adding that much value in today's market, so we can eliminate them? Maybe there's other specific types of testing we're doing that our clients don't value that much. Maybe there's a level of background check or reference check or skills testing that we're doing that really aren't required. I'm not saying those things aren't needed, but maybe you're doing things that are above and beyond. You did them in 2018 and 2019 to really differentiate your services, but in 2020, if you cut them, that would reduce your cost of service without upsetting your clients. This is a time to look at diversification opportunities for your business. It could be a service line extension where you go into new skill disciplines that you have the recruiting ability to be good at, going to market expansion, new geographies that you can easily or effectively service, maybe because they're contiguously near to you, or maybe because you have a client that has a facility in that location and that client wants you to be in their market. This is the time to look at product line extensions, creating entirely new services. So we're hearing a lot about online staffing, and I mentioned it once earlier. This might be time to look at that entirely new service as a way to digitize what you do from a staffing perspective. Go through a transformation where you can deliver your services completely through a mobile app, from recruiting to service delivery to QC, again, all without having to physically talk to the customer. There also may be other ways to move up the value chain, whether it's remote on-site management, or I talked to a company that's expanding their MSP services. I talked to them last week. They're looking at new ways to provide value at a higher level. You also might look at breaking your services apart, maybe taking your direct hire and unbundling it. So you sell just sourcing, or you just sell the vetting process or reference checking. If you need to do things to keep your recruiters busy and employed, creating new lower cost services is another way to diversify and create new opportunities. This is a really important time to broaden your client base. If you're dependent on a small number of clients, you don't want to have that dependence because it puts you at great risk if those clients stop using staffing. So even though staffing companies might not like the onesie-twosie kinds of sales as much, this is the time to get more of them, to go from having dozens to even hundreds of occasional users of staffing, because collectively that large number of small clients may outweigh the big clients and there's less competition to win them. This is a time to be more proactive in helping your clients plan ahead, to have meetings with every client, to help them look at their forecast for their own business, not just staffing, but how they see their business playing out over the next 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, and how that will impact their needs for talent. What types of talent? When will they need it? What do they anticipate? How are they going to handle if there's a second outbreak in your community? How are they going to handle an unexpected increase in absenteeism because people being sick or just afraid to go to work or making too much money on unemployment? It's time to manage your own financials more aggressively and upgrade your technology. And again, that's the same advice you're seeing from lots of the experts, is be better about managing your cash. Use technology to improve your efficiency. And of course, since this is our article from 2006, there was a lot on marketing. And we want to encourage people then, as we do today, to really be smart about marketing. Using marketing, first of all, integrated direct marketing to help salespeople be more productive. Using a combination of snail mail, email, social outreach as a way to supplement your sales calls to make salespeople more productive, so they have more real meetings with clients and prospects. Finding new low-cost and no-cost direct marketing ways to stay top of mind. I don't know about you, but I'm talking to you today from in my own office. And today, mail inbound, I had exactly nothing arrive. Zero came to my desk. Sending a personal letter, a note card, not expensive, but it stands out in these current times. If I'm going to send email to people, I have to think about ways to make my subject lines, my emails, more engaging. We've been using video emails as a way to stand out. If I'm going to reach out on social media, because everybody's reaching out on social media, I need my connection request on LinkedIn to be stronger. But more importantly, the next message. What do I say? How do I make it very powerful so people want to talk to me? Looking at targeted promotions to drive response. Maybe it's skill marketing more people. Maybe it's coming up with temporary discounts. Not a big fan of discounting, but if you can create incentives for purchase that are win-win, promotions are a great way to drive faster response. Using education, you could do webinars like this, or you could sponsor webinars to teach people how to staff better, how to deal with their challenges. This is a time to actually build your talent network so that when a client has a need, you can fill the job order faster, because first to fill is going to win. This is a time to update your website so that you can provide better service to clients and increase by getting more conversions from your site. This may be a time to repackage your services into new solutions by maybe breaking services apart, as I mentioned earlier, or creating new categories of service. This is a time to get your sales and service team into those client meetings more often so you can better tailor your plans for each client. Most of you probably already do custom tailor plans for each client, but how could you do it better to be more proactive, more responsive to what your clients need? This is a time to get more involved in your community in ways you can, partially to improve your own visibility and networking, partially because supporting your community is good for all businesses and all people in your community. And then this is a time to do more market research, whether it's through surveys or interviews or focus groups, so you really understand your clients' businesses, their industries, what's going on in their heads, so you can do more to help. In 2008, we had an article with just five things to do to get through the Great Recession. Again, the first bullet sort of repeats the last. Help clients to plan ahead. Get a jump on the competition. Be more aggressive using multiple channels of communication so that you're more visible than they are. So you strengthen your positioning more than they do to give yourself an edge. This is the time to really focus on ROI. Why should someone use staffing now? How are you helping businesses to cut their costs? How are you helping them to drive productivity, to capitalize on opportunity, to manage risk? This is a time for lots of education. So not lots of selling, but lots of training, teaching people how to be better users of your services, how to have a better relationship with a staffing company, why that's so important to their business. And most importantly, don't wait to get started. If you've already put marketing on the back burner, you slowed down, you know, this stat here at the end is critical. Aggressive advertisers obtained 4.5 times the market share gain of competitors who cut back on marketing during recession. So that's 450% more market share gain than people who cut back. So if you want the gain at the expense of your competitors, be more aggressive than they are right now. All right, something you're probably hearing a lot of. When someone says, we're not hiring, what do you do? Well, step one is to try to avoid ever getting that question. We don't want to be asking people about their hiring. We want to ask better questions about their business challenges, how they're addressing them, how they're forecasting the future, how they're dealing with their skill needs, what skill needs they're going to have. Get them thinking about the future, not just the present, which may be we're not hiring. This is going back to Sales 101. You know, every sales trainer in the world has told you, do your homework. Really study your clients. Understand their pains. Come prepared with really good solutions. I've seen lots of HR people on LinkedIn complaining that our industry has become tone deaf because we're just asking people about their need to hire. Well, no, we're really helping to, right now, find the pain points that staffing users, employers are going through, and even job seekers that they're feeling, so that we can leverage those pain points to make more compelling arguments to talk to us, more compelling arguments to use our services. We want to drive out costs now, show how your services drive costs out for your clients. You want to show how your services enable your clients to capitalize on the opportunities to free them up to do more, either by providing extra resources, providing specific expertise, or providing just people so that you're freeing their key resources to do more. And this is also a time for strategic recruiting. The positions that you're regularly filling or that you, your clients have told you they're going to need, to start recruiting in advance of those needs so you'll be the first to respond. Again, speed's going to win. How about branding? You know, and branding, marketing, you know, we've already talked about it 3 or 4 times. You know, you need to do it. It's non-negotiable. You lose visibility, you lose market share. Companies that market more, fall less and grow faster. And if you're doing regular marketing and you're sharing promotions, you're sharing articles, you're sharing your blog posts, those are all things your salespeople can talk about and gives people a reason to make better sales calls. But what about branding? Well, branding is something that usually is going to get cut in a recession. But if you think about branding, right now it's a time to strengthen your positioning, and that's what brand marketing does. It says, here's who we are and what we do and who we serve. It creates brand difference, and it creates brand preference. Here's why we're different. Here's why you should want to work with us. And it clarifies for your clients, your candidates, and every bit as importantly, your internal staff, what you want to be known for. And there are 3 different types of brands. You could do 1, 2, or all 3. There are personal brands, having your salespeople build their own brands online so they're more visible. Creating product or service brands around your processes. This is the ABC staffing methodology, and here's why it's different. Or market brands, like for a specific type of talent, here is why we're the best in Minneapolis, why we're the best in Cleveland. Those are 3 types of brands, and they work together if you can do all 3, but if your time and resources are limited, you can do any one of them. And one of the things staffing companies often are reticent to do is the personal brands, because they don't want clients to be loyal to individual recruiters. But those recruiters amplify your message. You absolutely want your recruiters on social media, via email, doing more to build your company's brand and build their personal brand at the same time. All right, so we're going to wrap things up with just a few remaining slides. A recap, what do winners do differently in a recession? First thing is they play defense. Get prepared as early as possible. Cut those non-essential costs. Use process automation and just streamlining, simplifying process and their procedures to be better at providing service to clients and candidates. They focus on building relationships, wider relationships, deeper relationships. They try to sign long-term contracts wherever it's possible. They build around their core strengths to try to be the best in the world at what they do so that they are irreplaceable. They are essential to their clients' businesses. They look at their cash flow and they divert some of the money to build a cash cushion. Now maybe again, you got that PPP money and we're gonna put an extra 50, 100, 200, 500,000 in the bank as a cash cushion, but we're going to invest the balance. And they don't get comfortable. In fact, they question everything they do. But right now, the winners get to go on the offense. They market aggressively to make sure that they're not invisible and that they're more visible than their competition. They make investments in technology and in people to improve efficiency. They use this as an opportunity to top grade talent. There's so many good people looking for work. This is a time, if you've got some B and C players, to go find A's to replace them. They invest in R&D or digital transformation for their own businesses so that they can be one of those technology-enabled staffing companies that survives. This is a time to build around the core focus. And the analogy somebody used is like it's building a moat, and now I want to make the walls of my castle higher so that nobody can get in to take my core clients away from me. How do I raise switching costs so my clients can't leave? How do I provide extra types of service or extra value so that my competitors can't compete with my service offering? And if you can, again, it's a great time to go buy, to pursue mergers and acquisitions when companies cost less to buy. And maybe most importantly, don't make any of the mistakes on this slide. Don't panic. Now, hopefully, you know, we're 4 months in. If there was a panic, you're long past it. But I think some people are still feeling anxious, maybe even more so because this is just lasting. Panic leads to bad decisions. This is a time for planning, a time to focus on what to do next. And it's not just about cutting costs. It's about improving efficiency. It's about investing for tomorrow. Don't cut marketing. I'll say it third time. Out of sight equals out of mind. Out of mind equals perception of out of business. Don't slash your prices. That is not a way to win business. If you cut your prices, that's a signal to your clients that you used to be overcharging. So if you're going to do a discount, do something in trade. I'll cut my prices in exchange for exclusivity. I'll cut my prices in exchange for always being the first call. Don't just jump into a hot new market where you have no ability to recruit knowledge of how the industry works. If you do that, the incumbents in that industry are going to kill you and you're just going to eat up cash. Instead, make the things that you're jumping into, make them related to what you do. Or if you're going to go on a bigger jump into something new, then do it through an acquisition or do it through bringing in new recruiters who specialize in that skill discipline. And don't do like the armadillo or the hedgehog and just curl into a ball, assuming thinking, I know it's going to get better soon. It will get better eventually. The question is, will you be there when it gets better and how fast will you recover? And the companies that are progressive, playing that mix of offense and defense, they recover the fastest and the strongest. We saw in 2009 companies who saw positive growth within 6 months of the recession starting, whereas most companies were 18 months. We saw companies that average 10% plus growth rates when the staffing industry was around 5 or 6%, and they did it because they were progressive in 2009, 2010. This is the time to create your marketing strategy. Segment your clients. Who are we going after? Use things like direct marketing to make your sales team more efficient. Use things like email, pay-per-click advertising, social media, and email to keep yourself visible and top of mind to help your salespeople be more memorable. This is a time to think about bundling services or creating incentives for purchase. Give people a reason to buy from you right now. It's time to do more skill marketing. So when you have amazing people that are suddenly in the marketplace, help them find homes faster. This is a time to be a resource for your clients with content marketing, educating, adding value, helping your clients solve their problems so that they see you as different than every other staffing company that just wants to sell temporary staffing or direct hire services. This is a time to broaden your client base so that you're less dependent on any key accounts. This is the time to talk to accounts and figure out new things you could do to solve problems for them, new services to offer. Again, this is a time for automation to improve that client or candidate experience. This is a time to look at new business models. Online staffing, it's one of them, MSP services, remote, workforce management, all could be examples. This is a time to go deep with clients to help them develop their own workforce plans. If you've never done workforce planning, go read up on it. Teach your salespeople how to develop workforce plans. Teach your recruiters and then consult with your clients to help them plan ahead. And lastly, two pieces of favorite advice. Number one, some of my dad used to tell me in past recessions, he goes, we choose not to participate. And it wasn't just a platitude that he said to the people in the office. He said, no, we've got a strategy because in a recession, business for the overall economy is going to go down. But that doesn't mean it's going to go down for our company because we're not dependent on the overall economy. Some companies will do well in the coming months and years. Some companies that maybe shouldn't, but they will despite the economy. Some companies will do poorly where they could have done better. And the companies that choose not to participate have a plan to get more aggressive in selling, marketing, and how they approach pricing, a plan to focus on the places where they can add the most value and really stand out, where they become more essential. And they invest in training and product development or creating services or enhancing services to crush the competition. Again, to be not only different, but the best in the world at what they do and essential to their clients. And the corollary to that piece of advice was to make the recession the other guy's problem, going after the competitors who are not going to come out of this and get their business. And we've got like 40 million people unemployed. However, most Americans are still employed. And most staffing business, the majority is still happening. So your challenge is to go after the business that your competitors aren't holding on to because their clients don't love them. This is a time for more volume of sales activity and smarter sales activity. This time might be to hire away top employees to top grade talent. And this is a time to recruit more so you can fill job orders faster, to build your own pipeline of talent, to build your network so you're less dependent on advertising. Maybe you'll spend less on job ads and you'll get more referrals that cost less the job openings that you have. All right, so your takeaway, what to do starting this afternoon, starting next week. Review all your clients. Ask your team to assess where are our relationships, where we have strong ones, where are the weak ones. Where are we really adding value and where are we just a vendor? Do we have a strong understanding of each client, their challenges, their staffing needs? Do we know their plans for the next 90 days? Are we doing everything possible to help those clients prepare for the downturn? If not, what more could we be doing? It may not be just selling staffing services, maybe using your expert in talent management to help them solve problems. Because those are the things you could be doing to be more essential to every one of your clients' businesses. And then literally create a plan. It just can be bullet points, can be a piece of paper, can be in an Excel spreadsheet, it can be a notepad, but every client should have a plan, what you're going to try to help them to do based on what the client needs and where they perceive their business going. All right, and so we're going to open it up for Q&A. We've got about 5 minutes left for questions, and I'll stay on later if we have more than 5 minutes worth of questions. While we're going out for questions, there's a couple of resources I'll share with everybody. The first is a web page. So I mentioned that today's presentation was a summary of a summary. So if you want to see the long format of these articles, you can go to haleymarketing.com/COVID-recovery. There's 3 on-demand webinars there. There's 2 long format articles and a whole bunch of other stuff, including some discounts on our services that you can take advantage of. And lastly, we formed a Slack group for those of you who use Slack. It's a discussion board where people can go and just share ideas, share things they're seeing, sales, marketing, recruiting, technology, just morale building, chat. Our teams are sharing a lot of stuff in there. It's completely free to join, and you just go to haleymarketing.com/staffingworks to join the Slack group. And with that, are there any questions?
Wonderful. Thank you for the very detailed webinar today, covering lots of topics here. If you have any questions on the items covered today or something specific to, you know, kind of what you're looking for, please go ahead and submit that using the chat or Q&A feature. While we're letting people kind of take a thought, you know, a moment here to think about what they'd like to ask, can you tell me, you know, what are, you know, some of the biggest questions that you are seeing or suggestions that you'd like, you know, people to come away with today to say, you know, here's what we are hearing. You deal with a lot of staffing companies. You may have a perspective to share on that.
Yeah, I think the biggest question is a real tactical one. Like, how do we sell remotely? We're used to, like, our salespeople went to people's offices. We make calls in person. Some people actually, you know, still cold call knocking on doors. And the answer is you need a process that stands out because you're going to have to do it digitally. So I was on another webinar, and one of the speakers said he recommends 16 touches over 12 weeks. So you need something that's multi-touch. We recommend using multiple channels of communication, email, video email, social messaging, primarily probably going to be through LinkedIn, but maybe you connect with people on Twitter or on Facebook, but primarily it's going to be LinkedIn. Phone calls and voicemail messages, and actually planning this into a process to target the businesses you want to do business with and having this deliberate process that your sales team is following. But it's really about reinventing the outbound sales process for one that works well, that's remote, and also is different. And I'd be remiss if I said, and also don't ignore direct mail in the mix, because as I mentioned, people aren't getting any direct mail, so anything you send is going to stand out.
Wonderful. I think that is one of the biggest questions, too, that people are interested in is, you know, what will this look like in the future? You know, the remote aspect may be here to stay long term, and finding some new solutions around how to go about that is definitely worth spending some time investing in that strategy.
Yeah, related to things that are going to be here for the foreseeable future, too, I've seen a lot of companies that are having success not just marketing their services, but focusing on what they're doing to bring safety measures to their clients. The policies and procedures that you're implementing, your clients want to know that you're paying attention, that you've got your workers' health in mind and their workers' health in mind, and you're going to be really serious about it. You might even go so far as to supply, you know, policies to clients or even supply physical goods. I saw a company that makes doorknob covers and door bar covers that you can use for like a month, and then they're microbial. They automatically disinfect every time you touch it. What a great thing to send to some of your clients is saying, hey, we're just thinking about how you reopen safely. You know, just show that you care.
Wonderful. Great advice. Again, if you have any questions or like additional information, Haley Marketing's contact information is up on the screen. We'd be happy to speak with you on a one-on-one basis if you have further questions outside of the webinar session today. We will also have a recording available on our website at trechem.com. Feel free to look for that or share that with your co-workers, or if you'd like to hear it again. We will also provide a handout for anyone who is interested, so feel free to reach out to me directly. I put my contact information here up on the screen, and I'm happy to share that with you. Again, thank you for participating in today's webinar. David, thank you very much for going through in such great detail and some really great strategies for staffing companies to come out of this challenge successfully. We appreciate you joining us today, and we hope that you will join us in future webinar sessions and watch for information on our next session. With that, I think we'll go ahead and close up today's session. Again, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Amanda. Thank you, everybody, for participating today.